And then Ed Wegener, a little out of breath that late afternoon, fairly rushed in to speak to us. The date was May 7th, 1968, and as we all had heard, then Governor Lurline Wallace, wife of former and future Alabama Governor George C. Wallace, had died earlier in the day. Could our little quartet, he asked, fresh off a milestone performance with the crowd just now trailing away, come on TV live this very evening and share our music with a statewide audience? Ed was director of the public television station on the Auburn University campus, a link in what was, from the 1950s, the nation's first statewide educational television network and the model for later ETV networks around the country. It would later become Alabama Public Television. He had called me once before, following a mention by our professor, to discuss our doing a little segment for TV. On this occasion, though, he had an urgent need, an appropriate and distinctive way to pay tribute to Governor Wallace on his evening program. The fact that Sacred Heart represented native music and tradition from the rural South and rural Alabama in particular, that it dealt with the themes of death as well, all of this seemed to him to fit the bill. Having just finished our version of a marathon then, we were now being asked to race again and at a suddenly high altitude. So this most flattering request gave the four of us pause. Could we, should we do it? We would not have had a chance to rehearse, to adjust to a different format. I don't believe any of us had ever been to the studio before, and the program was to begin in only about 2 hours. Leaving the English hour setting, we would be going our separate ways, maybe having a bite of supper, and then gathering at the last minute to go live. But we were on a roll, and Ed was encouraging. We agreed to do it and got quick directions to the studio. Over the next hour or so, I took a luxury of relaxing a bit. Each of us had been so geared up for the day and somehow let the time get away from me. After making a few wrong turns in the dark and then having to reverse my way, I arrived at the studio dangerously late toward the hour the lights were to go on for us. The others, rightly nervous, were all there waiting. We had only minutes, seconds it seemed, to take in the studio configuration and get the order of the evening. There would be an introduction placing our part on the program thematically close to the intended tribute. After that, we were to sing a couple of songs from, once again, four bar stools stationed at the back of the studio. And then I was to join Ed, the host, behind a desk at the front where he would chat with me about Sacred Harp and our involvement in it. We were hurriedly shown the layout, including the platform on which sat the long desk, maybe a couple of feet out from the edge. Late as we were, I took all of this in with but a glance, a fact that would shortly turn out to be costly. Lights and camera, and suddenly it was our turn to sing. I sounded a pitch from the pitch pipe, and we launched into our first song. Wondrous Love would have been an obvious choice, and it's my guess for what we opened with. We then sang a second song, maybe Evening Shade or The Morning Trumpet. Following that, I walked around to the back of the platform, crossing through what must have been three cameras stationed in a semicircle facing it. This would not have been how a stage manager would have marked it off, but too late now. Ed greeted me there, and we sat down and had a brief, I hoped not too strained, conversation about the history and practice of Sacred Heart singing. Not a detail of which I recall, except for the tail end of the interview. When he thought it time to bring the chat to a close, Ed said something like, "Well, could we get you to sing another song for us?" Feeling fairly savvy now about television and the format, I looked out at the camera, smiled, and said, "We'd be happy to." With that, I pushed myself back in my rolling chair, pushing a bit farther than was necessary to clear the top and the legs of the desk. As they rolled, the back wheels of the chair dropped just off the edge of the platform. With not a second's hesitation, the chair and I together plunged backward, down, and out of sight. If I try now to think of which set of words in the repertoire seems most apt for that moment, the song Ocean comes to mind. The men, astonished, mount the skies and sink in gaping graves. The floor, only about 3 feet from my chair seat when I started falling, wasn't gaping, of course. It was flat and hard, but my astonishment was real and speaks to me still across the years. I was astonished, first of all, by the thing itself, the treachery of the chair wheels, the cruelty of a too narrow back apron of platform. Astonished that such a thing could be happening on live TV and in such a professional setting. Astonished at the quick reversal from moment of triumph personally and for the cause to a now public humiliation. And surprised even then at the length of my frantic, ricocheting internal monologue. Anyone who's ever had a great fall or harrowing escape knows the sensation of time slowing down as the seasons of one's life seem to pass before, or a maddening train of thought unfurls in frames almost. Now, it's possible that reconstructive memory has slipped in over time and rearranged or fluffed up my recollection of my thought process at the time, but I seem to remember well the following thoughts crowding across my consciousness in that blurred second or so of time. This can't be happening. This is live television. This doesn't happen. As I was reeling backwards, I almost expected that professional hands would reach out and grab me, save me from the fall, or that the camera would cut away. Even in that brief moment, I felt a latent sense of my own lack of physical grace, a tendency to klutziness over the years that had chosen this, of all occasions, to manifest itself once more. No, it can't be. I simultaneously felt astonishment, horror, outrage, yes, self-pity, and great need. Help! And yet I also knew that I and the situation both were doomed, that no help would come. And that I now must rise and face the music. I have to give Ed Wegener credit. He was a pro. With but a quick look at the camera and with a smile in his voice at least, well, we seem to have lost our tenor. He reached down to lend a hand and rescue some sense of order out of that unbelievable moment. Extricating myself from the chair, now flat on its back, I picture a backflipped cockroach, legs flailing. I next had to reach up, take hold of the desk, and pull myself up. That image actually fit with my colleague's visualization. Tom, our bass, recalling the episode years later, told me that with their view shielded by the cameras, the three of them had watched the fall on a nearby monitor, and next saw my feet slightly waving above the desktop, like an insect's antennae. Nothing is more intolerable in live television than dead time. Seconds are precious. Any vacuum must be quickly filled. And even in my despair, this deepest of funks, I knew that. In the few seconds I remained out of sight from the camera, oh, how I wished I could remain there. I was swamped by dread. But it was useless to think I could remain out of sight or now out of mind for all who might be watching. Fastening my hands on the desktop above me, I pulled myself up to face the central camera, which loomed before me like some great alien eye. It seemed to leer, hungry for footage, for the satisfaction of its now heightened, autopsy-driven curiosity. The lead cameraman later said that ordinarily he could have cut away as he saw me start to fall, but that at that moment He had zoomed in for a close-up. I don't recall the next frame of action. There must have been a moment equivalent to dusting myself off or being dusted off. If I managed to bring up a smile, it could only have been through contortion. This was black and white television. I wonder if I was flush or if all color had drained from my face. In any case, what happened next was a study in crisis behavior. Adrenaline had kicked in for all of us. I walked briskly back to join my companions at the four stools, each of us concentrating mightily. As the cameras swung around and watched, we took a pitch and started singing. Not cheerily, to be sure, but more like soldiers on a fast march. When at last it was over and the final notes had fallen, it was as if a gigantic balloon full of compressed air suddenly and fully exhaled. The cameramen turned the cameras off and fell on each other with laughter. The studio erupted. All save one laughed uncontrollably. Across the airwaves in Alabama and bleeding over, I think, into a couple of neighboring states, a you'll never believe this event had happened. Friends who had watched now called each other and exchanged shouts of disbelief with peals of laughter. My future mother-in-law had viewed the program while knitting an afghan. She said afterwards that she had looked down for a moment, concentrating on a pearl stitch perhaps, and looked back up to see that I'd simply disappeared. Amid the laughter and still the disbelief in the studio, I think we did the briefest of postmortems. There must have been apologies, and apologies for laughing, and then more manic, cascading laughter. It seems to me now that the how could it have happened question was quickly broached and then thrown aside. My memory on these particulars is hazy, for I was preoccupied with my grief. I should add that the singing segments, as planned, had been recorded as they happened. The interview and my fall had not. Tape, after all, was expensive. So this event of singular awkwardness was but a moment in time and in memory. Over the years, I met a surprising number of people who had seen the fall. Oh no, that was you? I saw that! Besides those who had already been watching, others had simply been changing channels from the few available in that simpler era and had paused momentarily on public TV and caught the action. I later read that the famous space scientist, Wernher von Braun, had fallen off a platform at some official ceremony in Huntsville, where he lived and worked. And, of course, there have been famous stumbles by presidents and celebrities in front of the camera. That shared distinction helped a small amount. But did any of them, or anyone at all, have a more spectacularly abrupt disappearance from the TV camera's dead-on view? Was there a more earnest victim than this thin, callow 23-year-old who then had to try to walk over and sing it off? And who, watching, could have kept from hard laughing, if not from running out to tell the neighbors next door? In time, of course, the landing, played over in my mind so many times, has softened, and I have since been seasoned with other little shocks and reversals. Material for another memoir, perhaps? The story at last became one I could tell and appreciate with some humor. I leave the episode with one question more. Did I, as a young man, fall hard for Sacred Heart? Oh, more than I can say.